Okay, well, I got two coats on last night on the bare wood, and you saw me do that, and so you can see how beautiful this is. It's just bone dry. It's a really warm, dry day here in Texas. It's about 80 degrees and low humidity. So before I apply two more coats, I need to scratch the surface. I can feel that the grain is ever so slightly raised, or perhaps some foreign particles settled in my finish. So I want to scratch it ever so lightly and just make sure that I've got an absolutely smooth surface, and then I'll vacuum it the same way that I did before. Normally what I would use is I'd use a 220 or a 320 no-load paper, usually the no-load papers, and that means that you can use the paper on finishes and paints without it clogging the pores, that it doesn't load into the pores of the paper. I think a lot of times it's also called open coat paper. And this Vitex paper is my favorite, but I only have 120 and 150, and that's too coarse for this. I did find a small piece of 320 brand new paper. This is that this is a Canadian paper. I can't remember what it's called. It's very good. And then I also have a sheet of, I use this Mirka paper. Even though this is wood paper, it's technically not an open coat paper. It's for sanding bare wood. As light as I'm going to sand this, I can make this work. Okay, so I want to talk about the term that I constantly use when I'm finishing, and it's the term scratching. And not a rapper, but I use it. I use the term when I'm using a 320 or a 220 paper on a finished surface, that all I'm doing is lightly scratching the surface. I'm not busting through the finish down to the wood. All I'm doing is scratching the surface of the finished material, so the next coat that lays on actually has something to mechanically bind to. You know, that's why a lot of times you're in painting and in finishing, you're supposed to rough up the surface so that the next coat has something really good to grab onto. So that's what I mean. That's the term that I use. I keep using it all the time, scratching. Cleaning out the little embedded particles that fell down. And in this case, I think that the two coats that I put on last night, I'm feeling a little bit, but I think I'm not feeling so many embedded particles, like foreign material that settled into my finish. I think I'm feeling some raised grain from putting the liquid finish on, and maybe some of the grain popping up. You know, when you have this really highly figured wood like this, where it's highly figured because the grain keeps reversing and reversing. So in some places you have just almost complete end grain, and some places it's flat. And so in different places, yeah, that's what it feels like. And in the flat places, it feels like the grain has raised a little bit, where the fibers are laying down versus them just completely sticking straight up like that. So I think that in these places, yeah, that's what it is, definitely. The flatter ones. And so what I'm doing is I'm just knocking those off with just some 220 or 320 sandpaper, getting my surface etched and scratched for the next coat. And if you try to do, you know, it's almost an addiction when you start doing these Waterlox finishes. The more coats you put on it, the better it looks. I mean, and you go, oh, I just want to put one or two more coats on because it just looks like it's just been dipped in honey. You know, it looks so fantastic without that goopy look that so many finishes have. And but you can't put 5, 6, 7 coats on one after another and get the kind of finish that I'm talking about. You have to do 2 coats, 3 coats, scratch. Lightly. I'm barely putting any pressure, just enough to hold the paper flat. Just enough to clean the little particles off. And see, that already feels just baby butt smooth now. So a lot of times I do my finishing at the end of the day, where I'm in my shop, I'm not moving boards and material around, where I'm stirring dust up. I'm not using power tools or my dust collector that are blowing and getting a lot of airborne material in the air that then's eventually going to have to settle. So a lot of times I do my finishing at the end of the day after I'm done with my power tools and things have kind of settled down. I clean up a little bit. I come out and I do my finishing, then I close my shop and just let everything just be still and quiet. Then I come out the next morning and it's dry and ready for me to either set it aside and get back to work on something else, or tackle the finishing at that time again. But I rarely do that. I usually wait 24 hours. I'm almost always finishing in my work area. And so you can, using this low-tech technique, you can finish in your work area and produce a really quality finish without having to have a dedicated spray room or finish room. This Waterlox is a very forgiving finish. So if you do get a bad run or a drip, or you missed a spot, well, it takes nothing to just come in and scratch it and float it out, and then the next coat will just make it just disappear. Sometimes it may take two coats to make a spot where you really had to scratch it disappear. But and there are times where I'll come in with even an electric sander on tabletops. If I'm waterloxing tabletops, I'll come in with an electric sander and I'll use 320 no-load paper in my half-sheet sander with the power cut all the way down, and I'll just power that top with the electric sander, and it does a beautiful job. So I can do it really quickly, then vacuum clean up, apply another coat. But that no-load paper is the key, because it doesn't matter what kind of, you know, this, like I said, this white or blue paper is really the ticket, but I don't have it in 220 right now. Or 320, but this is the ticket for sanding any kind of paint or finished products, and it will not clog the paper. It's designed for that. That's what industry has designed it for. But yeah, we're just ever so lightly etching the surface of this just to get those embedded particles out and any raised grain. Because I got this on so straight and uniform last night that I don't have to do anything other than this. I don't have any spots where I've got overfinish or a drip or a gloop. But you cannot use wood cutting paper, like the red type paper, to do this. It will just you'll just have big globby clogs in it. That's designed for cutting bare wood. And I have tried using the black paper, the wet dry paper, and it does a fantastic job. But it's a mess though, because as you soak your paper in mineral spirits, and it does a fantastic job. It cuts, but then it leaves all the residue on, and so then you have to use mineral spirits to clean that residue off, and then you still have to go in and do the whole vacuuming and wiping treatment. So I much prefer to do it in a dry manner. I mean, the wet dry paper works great, but the less toxic fumes I have to be around, the less mineral spirits I have to use, that makes me happy. I don't like it. I've had exposure to way too much of it in my life, plus it's expensive. And why be wasteful and use something like that if you don't have to? But as cloudy as this looks, and you can see that I'm barely, but I am pulling something off. You can see that that's the powdered Waterlox dust that we've got to get rid of, or otherwise we're just going to trap that dust in our finish. So I'm going to vacuum that, I'm going to wipe it, and then I'm going to do the hand cleaning action like I showed you in the first stage. But as cloudy as that looks, you think, oh no, you've damaged your finish. You haven't done it, you haven't damaged it at all. As soon as you clean that off and put the Waterlox on, it'll be even more brilliant than last time. And it'll use a lot less material, because now there's not as much penetration into the wood. Now you're laying finish really only on top of finish, so there's not as much penetration. So I bet I will use, to do two coats like I did last night, I bet I will use half the amount of Waterlox that I used last night. But I'm almost done here, and then I'm going to start vacuuming.